coalition forces and begin striking selected targets of military importance.
It would be a decision which could only be taken once.
There's no argument over the choice between peace and war.
Unconfirmed reports about Gaddafi being captured.
This morning, I want to talk about
the future.
I would
like to focus on the European and US stance in the Ukrainian crisis. How come the US would get openly involved in the domestic policy of Ukraine, a country located on the opposite side of the globe, and at the same time issue stern warnings against the involvement of Ukrainian closest neighbor Russia, which is sharing almost 2,300 kilometers of common border with that country? Or why would the EU, already challenged by a rise of ultra-rightist sentiment across the continent, support a bunch of ultra-rightist and neo-fascist groups as an instrument of the regime change in Ukraine? Why would the US and EU put their stakes on same and beaten political figures who already had a chance to take the country in the right direction and showed they were unable to do so? The interim Prime Minister Yatsenyuk served in the government of Ukraine as Minister of Economy in 2005-2006, as Foreign Minister of Ukraine in 2007, and the Chairman of the Verkhovna Rada, which is the Parliament of Ukraine, from 2007 to 2008. I have posed these and other questions to our guest speaker, Jan Tykau, the Director of Carnegie Europe, the European Center of the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace in Brussels.
I think what we're seeing is a genuine revolution going on. We see the population or a part of the population of Ukraine that was very, very agitated, very stubborn and very determined to change the power relationship in the country, and that actually managed to do this. And this, of course, came out of a profound unhappiness about the general situation in the country, but also about the situation of Mr. Yanukovych not to sign the association agreement with the European Union. Now, this is on the surface what's going on, and I think that's really, you know, kind of the trigger. And we shouldn't forget that this is a genuine revolution. It's not just some kind of orchestrated thing. It's not just some kind of show. It's a really pretty profound shattering of the political situation in Ukraine itself. But apart from this, of course, something bigger is also going on, and that is that this revolution basically is part of a greater kind of reordering of the post-Soviet space. After the end of the Soviet Union, the post-Soviet space never really kind of came to rest. It is still kind of simmering and festering, and it has not been properly sorted out entirely. And this is still going on. We see this in many, many countries, small and big, from the Caucasus to Central Asia and to the more western parts of Ukraine and so on and so forth, all the way into Belarus and even in Russia itself. And this is what's happening. This is an historical kind of process that will take much longer also. It's not done within a few years. But the events in Ukraine very clearly fit into that wider kind of historical pattern that's going on.
Why would the West support people who already had a chance to operate at the head of the country and actually failed?
Why would the West support anybody? The point is, I think more importantly is, you know, what is it that the Ukrainian people actually want? The Ukrainian people have been profoundly unhappy with most of their leaderships, and for good reasons, because corruption is rampant. The disregard of even the minimum standards of an open society is very, very obvious. Bad governance is everywhere. The economic situation is extremely dire. And as we were able to see when Mr. Yanukovych got under pressure, he didn't react as a Democrat, even though he was democratically elected, but he reacted with draconian laws that actually put him firmly into the authoritarian, if not in the dictatorial camp. And that, of course, is the key to this thing. Yes, democratically fair elections are one thing, but if then the person that gets elected or the group of people that get elected turn out to be not Democrats, then they can't just say, hey, listen, you know, we got elected in a democratic way. Democracy is more than just, you know, open and fair elections. It is also the actual political conduct of the elected. And this is the kind of principle I think that the West supports, regardless of who it is. The West has made tremendous mistakes in supporting people that didn't play by the rules. But the point is that, you know, then you try again. Then you have to give them another chance. And I think this is exactly what the Ukrainian people have been asking for. And that's exactly the kind of trial and error that the West, you know, supports. It's the kind of, you know, democratic pattern. You're unhappy with the people who rule you. You have to find a way to make that heard. In the end, it's the people who, you know, have to govern themselves. And then the people, you know, have to voice their concern. And I think this is what happened.
Okay, but then how do we explain that absolutely open involvement of the Western politicians in the process?
The point is that, you know, Western politicians are there in support of some principle of governance. You know, they are because they were extremely concerned about the undemocratic way and the authoritarian and dictatorial ways that the Yanukovych regime had taken. They had really hoped for a very long time that Mr. Yanukovych was interested in developing and modernizing the country. You know, this is the entire idea of the association agreement of the EU, was that the leadership in Ukraine, you know, is actually interested in developing the country. But it turns out that Mr. Yanukovych was not interested in developing the country at all, but, you know, only interested in political survival. But when they found out that they couldn't deal with the guy, you know, because he was not interested in that, and who was willing to turn Ukraine into a dictatorship just to stay in, just in order to stay in power, they had to defend the principle that they were operating on. And so they were siding with the people that were asking for democratic reforms, for a new constitutional process, for less corruption. That's exactly what the West wants to stand for, and this is what they demonstrated. It's very, very consistent.
We are discussing the position of the West in the Ukrainian crisis with our guest speaker, Jan Tykau, the director of Carnegie Europe.
Burning point.
As of now, we see radical ultra-rightist forces coming to power in Ukraine. We see a country on the verge of a civil war.
Yeah, I mean, it's very clear that what we need is a government that it can act decisively, but will act on the basis of, you know, of the rule of law and democratic values. And the point is that, you know, the forces that you were talking about, you know, these very worrisome forces, ultra-nationalists and, you know,
well, and criminals,
or violent demonstrators, that, you know, you have to fight them with the instruments of an open democratic society. And that's quite possible. You know, a democratic country can defend itself against these kinds of forces. That's possible. I mean, we see this playing out in the West all the time. We have those people in the West as well, and the democratic system usually finds instruments to deal with them. But these must be fair and democratic instruments. It can't be the kind of clampdown of snipers on the rooftops of buildings around Maidan Square to just randomly shoot at people in the crowd. That's the kind of policy that Mr. Yanukovych was...
Why don't you think that could be the opposition snipers?
Well, that was a problem as well, obviously. I mean, the opposition didn't entirely have their own people under control. That was a problem as well, quite clearly. And this is something that the opposition now needs to take care of. Obviously, there needs to be discipline and rules and the rule of law on their side again. The point is that, you know, in an open democratic society where you can challenge institutions and don't go to jail just for saying that you don't like the government, you can deal with these forces much, much better than in an authoritarian regime that will have to apply ever more violence to curb the opposition. I think this is the lesson that Mr. Yanukovych has learned. And this is the lesson, of course, that Mr. Putin hated to see, that you can actually, you know, in the long run, not really subdue a people that wants more freedom with violence.
But Mr. Tykau, when we're talking about Mr. Yanukovych, dictatorship is hardly the case. He was a weak ruler and he was hardly a dictator, was he?
No, that's not entirely true. When you actually remember over the last several years, at least the last 2 or 3 years in Ukraine, when you see what the domestic situation and how it developed, how it became ever more illiberal, ever more closed, ever more brutal, you know, ever more impossible to really voice your concerns. You know, the parliament was basically, you know, streamlined so that not a lot of opposition was possible inside parliament. This had turned gradually into a system that was a very, very robust authoritarian system, perhaps not a fully developed dictatorship, but very robust authoritarian system.
Like you said, Western politicians were very much concerned about what was going on in the Ukraine, and they chose to openly support the opposition, whereas they're making every effort to warn Russia not to get involved, though Ukraine is naturally much closer to Russia than to the US.
The interesting thing is the kind of double standard that is applied specifically by Russia when it comes to intervention in the internal affairs of another country. You know, the Western intervention is usually an offer, you know, like the association agreement, to join, you know, or get closer to the West and to play by the West's rule. But it's an offer that if somebody rejects it, then the West can't really do much about it. You know, Mr. Yanukovych was not forced by the West to sign anything.
He said no.
That's the kind of incentive that the West creates. Mr. Putin often as some other, you know, people in his position, often have different kinds of ideas. You know, the point of the West is entirely one, that the Ukrainian people actually have to make their own decision. And the West wants to help with that. This doesn't mean that the Ukrainians have to say no to Russians. Ashton and basically everybody, including the American presidents, have said over the last few weeks, you know, that we will not, you know, we are not interested in a Ukraine that all of a sudden says no to Russia. You know, we would be stupid to do so because, you know, the economic development of Ukraine depends a lot on its ties with Russia. We're not interested in a country that ruins itself.
When you're saying that Ukrainian people have been given a choice, we have seen no Russian politicians in the street, but we have seen a lot of Western politicians in the street. This is not exactly a fair game. But moving over to...
it's a very fair game. The point of Western politicians was not to force any kind of specific decision on the Ukrainians. The point of the Western politicians there was to defend the principle of choice. That you establish a democracy that isn't only about elections, but that is also about the rule of law and about accountability, less corruption, and, you know, not authoritarian kind of rule in the street, random detention and so on and so forth. That's not the kind of system that the West can really, you know, live peacefully with.
Something to consider is that the country is now split and that the active part, how come they were well armed?
They had another revolution 10 years ago, which utterly failed because then the post-revolutionary leaders, both of them, you know, turned out to be very incompetent.
But they're the people whom you're supporting now.
This is what I mean when I say, just imagine, you know, these are smart people. These are people who had 10 years of learning from their own experience of 2004. They were not sitting on their butt and not doing anything. You know, this is the kind of thing that often leaders fail to understand, that the people are actually smart, that you have educated people, that you have young people who are interested in building a future and who are having an interest in building a future in an open society. And they prepare, they organize, they learn stuff, they build groups, they discuss. You know, we need a much smarter Ukrainian government. We need a much, much kind of more flexible and innovative Ukrainian government. And the big question is whether the new kind of rulers that will emerge from the elections are actually smart enough to pull this off. The big fear is now that we have yet another revolution and that the leaders that come out of this will turn out to be incompetent again. That cannot happen because then we will not see Ukraine develop positively in the future. The policy is now to actually, you know, keep Ukraine economically afloat so that it doesn't default on its debt. A policy would be to support a constitutional process that, you know, builds a system that all Ukrainians can live with. A policy would be to find a way of accommodating the interests both of the Russia-leaning parts of Ukraine and the Western-leaning parts of Ukraine. A policy would be to take the fear away, you know, from those who think that now the new people in Kiev will basically, you know, destroy the country.
And talking about keeping it economically afloat, they're asking for something like $35 billion. Now, where do we get them from?
That's a good question. The European Union has suggested a few days ago a donors conference that would invite all kinds of people, countries and international financial institutions to get around the table and see what they can actually do. This would include Russia, the West, the United States, possibly other countries, but also the IMF, perhaps the European Bank of Reconstruction and Development, and some other financial institutions that could perhaps come in and form a consortium and put the money on the table. And then, of course, afterwards, which is equally important, when you actually have the money and want to disperse it, you need to give it in a way that it can actually make a difference. So this is a hugely tricky quest and one of the key questions that everybody's talking about at the moment.
If we actively support anyone, that might imply that we take on certain responsibility in case of his failure. What do we do if this government fails?
Well, we don't have a government yet. I think they want to have elections in May. So, you know, before we actually talk about the failure of government, let's have a government first. You know, and then if it fails again, I don't know. I mean, that's a scenario. I have no idea how that failure is going to play out. Does that mean, you know, bankruptcy? Does that mean state failure? Does this mean the oligarchs taking over? Does this mean the partition of Ukraine? I mean, all of these scenarios are possible. I can't possibly speculate about this.
Well, and with this huge question mark, we end this edition of Burning Point, brought to you by me, Katerina Kudashkina. Our guest speaker was Jan Tykau, the director of Carnegie Europe, based in Brussels. Thank you so much for staying with us. Goodbye, and take care.